After the well-received remake of Silent Hill 2, Konami is continuing to revive its iconic IPs, this time with a remake of Metal Gear Solid 3, reimagined as Metal Gear Solid Delta. For this project, Konami collaborated with Virtuous to develop the game using Unreal Engine 5. However, given Virtuous' shaky recent track record, particularly with The Elder Scrolls Oblivion Remastered, expectations were tempered, and unfortunately those concerns were justified, because this is one of the worst Unreal Engine 5 releases I have tested this year. Visually, despite the usual Unreal Engine 5 smearing and artifacts, the game still looks appealing, especially during the cutscenes, which are faithfully recreated to match the original. However, as a package, it falls short of standing among the best looking UE5 titles. And despite that, the performance is downright abysmal, and the holding 60fps, which is the frame rate cap, is quite challenging. And on the modest 3060 Ti, even at the lowest settings, which completely ruin the visuals by disabling shadows and lighting, the game still drops below 60fps, which highlights how poorly optimized this remake is. And to make matters worse, they didn't even bother adding a decent range of graphics options. The game only offers three main settings: shadows, textures, and global illumination. And that's it. So in this video, we are going to take a closer look at performance, see how much of a difference these settings actually make, and I'll also show you a few tweaks that can slightly help improve the overall experience. Let's first take a look at upscaling and image quality, and surprisingly, somehow they've managed to screw this up as well. DLSS quality does not render at 960p like it should, it instead runs at 1080p, or about 75% of 1440p, which actually corresponds to ultra quality. Balance mode is also shifted, running at 960p or around 66% of 1440p, which normally equals quality. In other words, the game mislabeled these modes, and the same issue carries over to FSR and TSR as well. Now, looking at these upscalers at 1440p using the in-game balance mode, which is actually the quality mode, the results are pretty much what you'd expect. FSR 3 suffers from heavy shimmering and stability issues, while TSR looks much cleaner. And this becomes especially obvious in foliage-heavy areas, which are basically the worst-case scenario for FSR 3. Additionally, all these upscalers tend to look soft and blurry, which brings me to the first tweak I highly recommend if you're upscaling at this resolution. To apply it, go to your AppData folder and follow this directory path. Then open the engine INI file with a text editor and add these lines, and don't forget to save. This will increase the sharpness of the image, and you can adjust the intensity to your preference. And as you can see here, setting it to 1 already improves image clarity noticeably. The game also supports DLSS 4 override through the Nvidia app, and as expected, using the Transformer model with preset K provides better image quality compared to the default DLSS preset C, though it still suffers from the usual desocclusion issue, as you can see here around Snake. Let's move on to shadows, which controls the quality of virtual shadow maps. Setting this to low completely disables all shadows, leaving the scene unnaturally flat. Switching to medium brings the shadows back, and increasing the setting further slightly improves the shadow detail and the penumbra softness. The setting also affects the shadow rendering distance, and on medium and high, there is more noticeable shadow popping compared to ultra, as you can see here. In terms of performance, there is an 11% cost when going from low to medium, around 13% when going to high, and 27% when going to epic. So for shadows, low should be avoided entirely. Ultra is not worth the performance costs, and both medium and high provide the best balance between performance and visuals. Next, we have textures. From what I have seen, this setting does not actually affect texture quality or anisotropic filtering. And one of the few positives about this game is that it's fairly efficient with VRAM usage. And I found that 8GB is enough even when using ultra textures. However, since there is no real visual benefit to using ultra, I recommend keeping this at high just as a safe choice in case VRAM usage becomes an issue in later sections of the game. And last but definitely not least, we have global illumination. This controls the quality of lumen, and similar to shadows, using low completely disables it. And since the game does not have a proper fallback, this significantly degrades visual quality. Going to medium enables lumen, and going further improves its accuracy and coverage. This setting also affects lumen reflections, as you can see here, with ultra capturing more of the scene and the reflections compared to medium and high. Performance-wise, there is about an 8% drop when going from low to medium, 10% when moving up to high, and around 24% when cranking it to ultra. And in other scenes like this one, we can see almost the same performance impact. So similar to shadows, I recommend avoiding low and ultra and keeping global illumination at medium or high. Now, while playing this game, I noticed some serious input lag, especially when the GPU is maxed out or the frame rate dips even slightly below 60 FPS. And when I monitored PC latency, it was spiking as high as 75 milliseconds, which feels terrible for a game like this. The interesting part is that the game actually supports NVIDIA Reflex, but for whatever reason, they didn't bother adding it as a menu option. So to enable it, we have to go back to the engine INI file and add this line. Once enabled, Reflex cuts the PC latency by nearly 50%, making the game feels noticeably more responsive. Another noticeable issue is how poorly and inefficiently particles and special effects are handled in this game. Even a basic action like rolling, which only spawns a small dust cloud, can drop FPS by around 16%. And I experimented with different console commands to reduce the performance hit from these effects, but without any success. The only solution I found was to disable them entirely with this command, which significantly helps avoid performance drops when effects like dust would normally appear, but unfortunately it comes with a major downside. Since most VFX and particles in this game rely on the Niagara system, this command wipes out a ton of visual flare, such as decorative leaves, rain particles as you can see here, or fire effects. And if you know of any commands that can help reduce the performance impact of these effects without removing them completely, let us know in the comments below. So given everything we've discussed so far, these are my recommended settings for Metal Gear Solid Delta. Now let's compare the performance and visuals of the optimized settings against the Ultra preset at 1440p using DLSS4 performance. Yes, you heard that right, DLSS performance. Because this is the only way to stay close to 60 FPS on the 3060 Ti. But at least I am using the Transformer model, which honestly holds up better than expected. And here we can see on average around 37% performance improvement when going from Ultra preset to optimized settings. But in more demanding scenes like this one, maintaining 60 FPS is still not possible, with performance hovering around 54 FPS. Now on the more powerful 4070 Super, I was able to push both shadows and global illumination to high instead, while using DLSS4 quality, and I was able to maintain more than 60 FPS in this section. So overall, I am not sure how they've managed to screw this up so badly. With the Oblivion remastered, I can find some excuses, as that was a visual remake and the original broken game was still running in the background, and it was an open world title. But Metal Gear Solid Delta sticks to the same segmented map structure as the original game, so getting this abysmal performance on a game that's using an old school level design is just inexcusable. And honestly, at this point, I'm not only blaming Epic and the developers, I am also blaming the end user. The game currently has very positive reviews and it's one of the top sellers on Steam. So why would Konami feel the need to fix these issues if the game is reviewing and selling so well? We've seen this pattern before with games like Monster Hunter Wilds, which is still plagued by performance problems to this day. So a big shift needs to happen, not just from the developers and Epic, but from us users too. Before ending the video, I want to give a quick shout out to my Patreon. If you are able and would like to directly support my work, consider becoming a patron to get access to the highest possible quality of my latest videos, including this one. And a big thank you to all my supporters, and thanks to you as well for watching until the end. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.